Good afternoon, good morning, everybody. And I thank the Water Research Foundation and Cal Nevada for the opportunity to come and speak about this important topic. I wanted to start off by acknowledging my co-author on this, Ying Wu, who's in the room, who's done a lot of this work. I also wanted to acknowledge that we have Ramona Bueg from Glendale, City of Glendale, the Assistant General Manager in the room as well, who's supporting this work. Former Assistant General Manager Peter Kavunas, who was involved for a long period of time, and Charles Cron from CDM, who is the man who actually makes it all happen at the demonstration facilities. So I'll talk a little bit, jump right into the technologies, because we've heard a lot about the toxicology now. We've heard a little bit about the chemistry of chromium in particular, so I won't even go into that. Talk specifically about the technologies, and we'll focus on what I'm considering at this point to be the leading technologies. And a little bit later, we'll hear some of the more emerging ones as well, things that are being tested. These are a weak base anion exchange, strong base anion exchange, reduction, coagulation, filtration, high pressure membrane filtration, and I'll go into each of these. And then I'll end the talk by talking a little bit about pilot testing guidelines. This was a Water Research Foundation emerging opportunity project that was done to help to set a baseline for testing. So what to look for when you're doing pilot testing or bench scale testing for that matter. And we'll talk about how to establish commonalities so that we can compare technology effectiveness for different water utilities. So the city of Glendale is in Southern California, and as we've heard quite a bit this morning already, has really been the leader in looking at treatment technology effectiveness. It started with a bench scale testing work that was actually led by Los Angeles Department of Water and Power, LADWP, in partnership with the cities of Burbank and San Fernando and Glendale. Also started as a Water Research Foundation project. That was really a very wide study. So we looked at all the different technologies that might be effective. That led into pilot testing of 7 of those leading technologies. And those were done at the city of Glendale under flow-through conditions, typically 1 to 2 GPM. And then that fed into identifying 2 technologies to test at demonstration scale. So now these are operational they're facilities that have been operational for 2 years now. There's 2 different technologies, the weak base anion exchange and the reduction coagulation filtration. And I'll throw up some acronyms, so before I get you guys into that, I'll keep talking about them until you can get used to the acronyms. We also had a bridge study, which was to go between pilot and demonstration in order to look at the mechanism of one of the technologies that we didn't understand at the time. So just to show you some of the pictures of the technologies, we have anion exchange, either in weak base anion exchange or strong base anion exchange, and I'll talk about the difference there, the reduction coagulation filtration process, and reverse osmosis. So now the idea behind weak base anion exchange, it is a fixed bed type of approach, so you have vessels of media that you flow water through. So if you follow the process flow diagram here, raw water coming in, you actually have to adjust this pH of the water to achieve about a 6.0, which can be a significant cost of this technology, as I'll show you in a second. Bag filters for this particular groundwater source just to protect the resin beds so that you keep a profile going through the resin itself. Flow through. And then we have it in lead lag configuration at the city of Glendale. Can also be done in parallel. And then a post-treatment process step. At Glendale, they have aeration, which is intended for VOC treatment, but it also increases the pH of the water. It's essentially removing the CO2 out of the water. And so you wind up stabilizing it from the perspective of corrosion control, because you don't want to introduce water that has a pH of 6.0 into your distribution system. So these are all concerns that need to be taken into consideration for different specific utilities. So this shows an example of the demonstration facility at Glendale. It's a 425 gallon a minute system. You can see in the back, we've got the lead lag vessels. This is the carbon dioxide pH suppression system, and the bag filters are here in the foreground. We do have a backwash water storage tank, which during the demonstration testing we've identified to be significantly undersized. So that's something that, again, also will depend on your sewer capacity, and there's a lot of different factors. But it's undersized for Glendale. Now I'll walk through each of the steps of the processes and highlight some of the key issues. One thing that people always ask me is, well, which technology should we pick? You know, what is really which will be the winner for Glendale? And the answer is it's not that simple. You have to actually consider all of these different potential issues and really weigh them on a very water quality specific basis and on a cost basis too. So I'll walk through here some pretreatment example approaches. A couple of different approaches were possible, using hydrochloric acid, using carbon dioxide. For Glendale, the doses are really high, and this comes from a high alkalinity of the water. It's about 200 milligrams per liter as calcium carbonate. And so it takes quite a bit of acid to drop the pH to 6.0, even though the starting pH of the raw water is 6.8. Now, Glendale represents about the 75th percentile of the state of California alkalinities. So it's a little bit on the higher end, but it's not out of the realm of possibility in terms of what the needs might be. So for a 500-gallon-a-minute system, when you're looking at acid versus CO2, it's really a trade-off of capital versus O&M cost. In this particular case, they did carbon dioxide because the potentially responsible parties at the site had concerns about having an acid right next to a neighborhood. So carbon dioxide was chosen even though the capital costs were higher. Now, since then, we've also started testing sulfuric acid because that can be actually a much more cost-effective option than hydrochloric acid if you want to go with a mineral acid type of approach. Now, these are some results from a recent study that Glendale's been doing in partnership with California Water Service Company at the city of Livermore, California. And here you can see a titration curve showing the amount of sulfuric acid that's required to get down to a pH of 6. And the other thing to really highlight here is that you're really at the steep point of this curve, and so maintaining your pH at exactly that right condition can be a bit of a challenge. So there's some necessary infrastructure there. Now, going into the resin itself, this is what the resin looks like. They look like chips, essentially, that are 600 microns on average. The difference between the weak base anion exchange and the strong base anion exchange is really the mechanism. The weak base anion exchange actually converts chrome 6 to chrome 3 and keeps it there, which is not your standard ion exchange. Ion exchange, normally, you just exchange an ion on, and you can exchange it back off by having, say, a salt brine at a higher concentration. You can kick it back off. But that's not what's happening with the weak base resin, and that's what's really unique about this particular type of resin, and is not true for all weak base anion exchange resins. So up until this point, we had tested 6, and only 2 had been shown to have a pretty high capacity for chromium. Now I'll show you some results presented as the number of bed volumes. And so how to think about bed volumes is it's the gallons of water that are treated divided by the gallons of resin that in your treatment system. So now essentially we get at Glendale, the number of bed volumes treated is about 170 to 190,000 bed volumes. And so I'm showing here in this graph the total chromium concentration. This is the raw water, and it's actually dropping. This is a plume that's pulling in water. If you look at the blue line here, this is the lead bed, so the first bed. At the same time, we had the lag bed running, which is the red, up until this point, at which point we exchanged out the lead bed, replaced it with a vessel of new resin, moved the lag bed into the lead position, and kept operating until the effluent from the lag bed was reaching 5 ppb. That was the main target here. So essentially, we were getting 170 to 190,000 bed volumes of operation, which corresponded to about a year to year and a half of operation of one bed of resin. This is a bed that's 185 cubic feet and 425 gallons a minute. So it has a very long life compared to, you'll see the strong base anion exchange resins are in the several thousands. So you get quite a big capacity. We actually saw about 1.4% chromium in the resin after it was done treating the water. So it's highly effective at concentrating chromium. As I mentioned, we're also testing a couple of new resins that have come to market and that have been tested in industrial facilities. These two resins are showing a little bit more sensitivity toward pH in our initial testing, where if we were slightly above a pH of 6.0, we were getting this initial breakthrough. But then that was dropping off as soon as we got the pH to 6.0 or a little bit below. So it really showed the importance of that, which is not true for the other resin. So these are two new resins that we're testing. The other one is called PWA7, Dow PWA7. So these are running right now at both Glendale and Livermore. The mechanism, as I mentioned, actually involves the reduction of chrome 6 to chrome 3, and we did the bridge study to really investigate that and to make sure that we weren't getting precipitates of chrome 3 on the bed that could then be sloughed off in a big massive event. So that was a major concern initially. How was it actually being? Well, first of all, we wanted to know if it was actually being reduced from chrome 6 to chrome 3. We suspected that because we saw. Like here you can start to see the green color, which is indicative of a chrome 3 compound versus a chrome 6 compound. So you see the bed turn into this greenish black by the time it's done. The other thing we did was we took the resin to Argonne National Labs and we did some speciation and we could directly analyze and determine that it was chrome 3. It was not present as chrome 6 anymore on the resin once it was there. We looked at the actual beads themselves, and we didn't see any precipitation on the exterior of the beads, so it was all incorporated and fairly stable. Now, we did look at everything from start to finish, so just to make sure that we weren't creating other problems with this treatment process. And so we looked at accumulation of key constituents, which also is important because it determines how you can dispose of the actual media once it's spent. When you can operate it out to 1.4% or 14,000 parts per million, that's when you can, you know, you get into a situation where you're generating a California hazardous waste. I'll talk about that in a second. You can also accumulate copper, vanadium, and it's extremely efficient at removing uranium as well, which was one of the unintended findings of this research initially. And so if you get to levels greater than 500 milligrams per kilogram, you can actually, that's the trigger for a low-level radioactive waste. And so these are all considerations that were in play when we first started. Now, another thing that we looked at was whether anything leached off of resins, because there'd been some historical information about how nitrosamines might leach off of resins that are not properly preconditioned. So we looked at that. We did not see any significant nitrosamines coming off the resins, but we did see formaldehyde, which was actually a concern for the city of Glendale. In California, there's a notification level for formaldehyde of 100 parts per billion. And so if you look at these results, on the left-hand side, the high numbers, that's when the bed first went into operation. It was not serving water because we were doing these tests to make sure. We did an immense suite of tentatively identified compounds, or ticks, where you look at a mass spec output and you see if there's anything unusual and you try to attribute that to some kind of contaminant. So we saw, you know, after the first about 10 days of the first couple days of operation, the concentrations were fairly high, and so the water was shut down to try to figure out what to do. After sitting for 10 days, it went up to 3,300. And so after then flushing for a little bit longer, and they were able to dispose of this water, luckily, but it's not necessarily an option that would be available to every utility, so it's a major consideration is how to properly precondition these resins to avoid this formaldehyde leaching issue. So we worked together with Dow and Siemens to develop a preconditioning procedure that included essentially a brine squeeze procedure or cross regeneration procedure. And so after that, the levels were quite a bit lower. These levels, all of the first ones, are for about 2 days after putting that bed back in operation. And then after 1 month, the levels are really low, below detection limits. Again, it's a consideration, and this is active research right now, looking at how to offer something to the industry to have this pretreatment process so that it's not a concern for a utility that can't waste a month of water. Right now, the backwash water is also one of the considerations for weak-based resin, having the ability to backwash and fluff the bed initially, and then having the forward flush water before you serve that. So there's a significant quantity of water generated. There may be some sewer discharge restrictions for Glendale. In this particular case, they're limited by formaldehyde. They have to have non-detect levels of formaldehyde. And so that's a significant issue. Now, post-treatment, as I mentioned, Glendale does aeration. They have packed tower aeration for VOCs. But we also did cost estimating for other alternatives, like sodium hydroxide or caustic solution, And we also have cost estimates for aeration with PAC Tower. And you can see we have this analysis in the final report of all this study, which is available to anyone who's interested. But there's a significant, again, difference between the capital and O&M expenditures. As I mentioned, the residuals are really one of the key drivers of the weak base anion exchange resin. From an operational standpoint, it's a very very easy technology to operate. So it takes minimal time compared to the reduction coagulation filtration process in particular. But it does have some significant issues associated with the formaldehyde and the startup. It's also the spent resin is considered a California hazardous waste. It's a non-RCRA hazardous waste, so it passes the EPA TCLIP test, but it fails the California wet test. It also, if you have uranium in your water, which Glendale did at 4 picocuries per liter, so a pretty low level of uranium, it does accumulate uranium, and so it becomes a technologically enhanced, naturally occurring radioactive material, T-norm waste. And that, again, puts restrictions on which facilities can accept that waste. And then there's the potential for that going into the even a worse classification, which is the low-level radioactive waste classification. For Glendale, that did not actually turn out to be the case, that they went into a low-level radioactive waste classification. So if you look at this simplified flow chart, which was done with, we did a study with the Association of California Water Agencies, AQUA. They specifically looked at this residuals issue because this was known to be one of the major issues that came out of the arsenic rule, not having a good understanding of what residuals issues were and what those costs could be. So this was a study that was done to look at that in much more detail. And so this shows you the pathway for Glendale in particular. Where it is a California hazardous waste, does have radionuclides, in which is uranium, but it stays below that 500 milligrams per kilogram or 0.05%. So it's not considered a source material or a low-level radioactive waste. If it is a low-level radioactive waste, there's one landfill that can accept waste from California, and it's in Utah, and it's significantly expensive. So the other option for a T-norm waste, so you have a T-norm non-RCRA hazardous waste, that for Glendale, they actually sent it into Idaho, which can accept the waste that had those particular requirements. Now, the concentrations that were removed of uranium were actually higher than the 500 milligrams per kilogram. But part of the processing of that resin involved adding a clay material so that you don't have free water product when you transport that off-site. And that actually brought the concentration down. So it's as a whole of your disposal. So just to summarize, the mechanism of removal for this weak-based resin is the reduction of chrome 6 to chrome 3. It is not easily regenerated. I didn't mention that before, but it's something that the vendors have looked at a little bit and are not particularly interested in doing. The incorporation of the chromium is actually into the resin matrix itself. The operational requirements, it does have this long life, which can be nice from an operational perspective, but there are some issues with the preconditioning and the residuals handling. Now, moving into reduction coagulation filtration. So now this treatment process, again, we have a raw water source here. We add ferrous sulfate. And here, unlike what Lori was talking about where you add ferric as a coagulant, you're actually adding the ferrous here to be a reductant. So you're reducing chrome 6 to chrome 3. You need to have something to oxidize your ferrous because you add the ferrous in a greater stoichiometric amount, so you have residual ferrous left. You don't want to send that through your filters and send it out to a distribution system because it will oxidize when you add chlorine or with time. We also added polymer in cases when we tried granular media filtration. So we did two different approaches here. And again, this was the Water Research Foundation and Proposition 50 funded work where we did granular media filtration versus microfiltration. And we looked at both submerged and pressure microfiltration. And specifically looked at the backwash issues associated with all of those technologies. So the polymer was only added when you had granular media. So now this just shows a couple of pictures of what this looks like. We have, again, ferrous sulfate, or iron 2, going to iron 3, at the same time reducing chrome 6 to chrome 3, so a redox reaction. And you can see the buildup of iron particles in the filters. This is a 100-gallon-a-minute system at Glendale. This is their demonstration facility. And I should mention that both of these facilities, demonstration facilities, do serve water. So they were permitted, and they are serving water to the customers. But what you see here, the reduction tanks, we actually had three reduction tanks in series so that we could look at whether you could optimize reduction time and maybe minimize that. So part of the process was, or part of the project was to see if we could minimize the footprint, because 45 minutes of reduction time is a pretty significant amount. And you'll hear a little bit more as the day goes on today about some more research into this issue. Then we had aeration, which you can't see behind the backwash water storage tank, and then the granular filters here. This dumpster-looking thing in the front is actually a passive dewatering sludge bait, it's called. So you put your backwash, your settled backwash water solids into that, and then you let it passively dewater through felt, essentially. So that's a possibility for smaller size systems. When you start to get to larger size systems, you might start to consider mechanical dewatering mechanisms. So now one thing that when we first started this work, when the bench scale work was underway, one thing that became really obvious was that reducing Chrome 6 to Chrome 3 is very easy. So all you have to do is just add a little bit of reductant, and you take care of it pretty easily. But the challenge is the removal of the Chromium 3. And so, and the reason for that is that you can actually see reoxidation of Chrome 3 to Chrome 6 under distribution system type of time scales, and even with, in this particular case, chloramine addition. Now, we did some jar testing as part of the microfiltration testing, and in that test, we added small doses of chlorine to see if we could use a little bit of chlorine to oxidize the ferrous to ferric before the microfilters, because we were seeing a little bit of residual ferrous get through the aeration process. We were seeing 0.1 of ferrous, 0.1 milligrams per liter. And that was just enough to be of concern to the microfiltration vendors in terms of fouling of the membranes. And so we looked at different concentrations of chlorine that could potentially be added. And we found that a 1 to 2 times stoichiometric amount of chlorine to iron, so 0.63 milligrams per liter of chlorine to 1 milligram per liter of iron was sufficient. And just to point out, we also found we looked at the different ratios of iron to chromium, and I'll talk about that in a second. Here in these particular cases, the ratios were 50 to 1. So we had a low concentration of chromium of about 15, and so our iron is 0.75, so it's pretty low. But we were seeing very minimal, if any, reoxidation at these if we kept the chlorine concentration below 0.2. So now walking through the RCF process, we looked at, again, the ratios, and we found that the 25 to 1 iron to chromium ratio was effective at high concentrations, but you needed more iron when you were at low concentrations. So, for example, 80 ppb of influent, which is one of the wells that Glendale's treating, required 2 milligrams per liter. And then also, if you're at 10 ppb, so we had a combination of different wells, then you also might need up to 2 milligrams per liter in some cases to get to get more effective removals. To show some jar testing results, these are for the high chromium concentrations. We got non-detect values for total chromium at those ratios of 25 or 50 to 1. And then you can see, I'm showing, this looks a little strange because you see less than 1, but you see bars here versus here. And that's because I'm showing the levels, even though they're less than 1. But you see essentially an improvement in as you increase the iron concentration when you're dealing with a low chromium concentration water. So now overall, we looked at the reduction time, 45 minutes, 30 minutes, 15 minutes. And these are the chromium 6 concentrations. And we saw a really good reduction down to 15 minutes with this one outlier. We looked at the next step, the oxidation of ferrous. And again, we saw some ferrous was getting through the aeration. So we just had a tank with a bubbler in it. And we saw that we did see some ferrous get through. And so we tried the chlorination. And then we had full oxidation, even with just a little bit of chlorine contact time. This picture shows the granular media filters and the results. There's a lot of different colors here because these are all different scenarios we looked at. But in general, we did see removals of chrome 6, or we saw reductions of chrome 6 to less than 1 ppb in almost every case. In terms of total chromium results, that's where you start to see the higher concentration. So we didn't get full removal of the total chromium under all cases. We got typically between 1 and 5 ppb. If you look at, there's the 5 mark. These are different different scenarios with aeration, without aeration, different scenarios that we looked at, different filter run times as well. This shows it a little bit of a different way with different filter run times. Filter run time didn't seem to have much of an impact, and we didn't see much head loss because the amount of iron that you're adding is actually pretty small. Again, we did microfiltration, and the point of this testing that was just completed was to see if we could get below 1 part per billion consistently for total chromium results, because we were only getting below 5 ppb with the granular media filters. And in fact, we did see that we could get non-detect levels in almost every case with microfiltration, and that is at pretty high flux for both units. So now moving into the residuals discussion for the reduction coagulation filtration. Essentially, what you wind up with is backwash water, either from your granular media filters that have to be backwashed at a certain periodicity, and you wind up with about 3% water as a result of the process on average. For the microfilter, you wind up with about 3 to 5%, depending. Microfiltration, you also wind up with the clean-in-place waste that you have to neutralize before disposal. But in general, there's a couple different options for your backwash water with RCF. You can dispose to the sewer if it's possible. For the city of Glendale, the limit to the sewer for chromium was 10 milligrams per liter for total chromium, and the highest concentration we saw in our backwash water was 7.4 in all the testing, the granular media and the microfilter. So that's a possibility there if you can handle the kind of quantities depending on your system size. Another possibility is to do solids thickening and dewatering, such as a scheme shown here, where you'd have an equalization tank, a thickener, dewatering, and that can help you if you're particularly interested in recycling some of that water to the head of the plant, which is something that we proved did not negatively impact the treatment process. And that's for the granular media filters. The microfiltration vendors did not recommend the recycle of the backwash water because they were concerned about fouling. The aqua residual study, again, looked at a number of different things. We looked at the hazardous nature of the residuals. If you do dewater those residuals, they are considered a California hazardous waste. They're a non-RCRA California hazardous, similar to the WBA, but they don't accumulate uranium. In terms of cost estimates, we did significant cost estimating, looking at different dewatering processes. And also looking at, for the weak base anion exchange process, we looked at the potential for different pH adjustment options and the resin life. We did jar testing of three other utilities' waters to estimate residuals volumes and whether that made a difference. And then we looked at the cost implications of potential MCLs. So this is a complete report that's available if you're interested. In terms of the sewer versus non-RCRA hazardous waste options, this is something that will be very dependent on your specific utility and your discharge limitations. We did a search of typical discharge permit restrictions for sewer around the state, and we found that they can range anywhere from 3.5 upwards of milligrams per liter. And so in some cases, it wouldn't be an option, but some cases it would. In terms of the RCF technology, chrome 6 reduction and total chrome removal, we generally saw smaller filter pore sizes, improved removal. So you got better removal with your microfiltration. So again, you'd choose based on what target you really want to achieve. You have higher iron doses, and it improved the removal and can also potentially reduce your reduction time. So that's something that's some ongoing work right now. Low doses of the chlorine did not significantly reoxidize the chrome 3, and we also saw that aeration and chlorine were both effective at oxidizing your ferrous, and the kinetics with chlorine are faster. So now jumping into the strong base anion exchange resin, essentially here we have a similar setup as the weak base with water flowing through the vessels. You have multiple vessels generally in parallel, or you can have them in lead lag depending on the size of your system. The difference here is that you don't need to adjust the pH at the beginning. You don't need to adjust it at the end necessarily, depending. And then you have brine for regeneration. So you have a much shorter bed life, and you regenerate it frequently. So these are some example pictures of typical strong base anion exchange installations. One interesting thing to point out here is that the brine waste can actually accumulate chromium to be hazardous waste and can actually need processing, which can essentially become a little reduction coagulation filtration process just to treat your brine. So now just to show a quick breakthrough curve of strong base anion exchange resin at two different utilities, this is highly dependent on the amount of sulfate in the water as the key difference. So the Glendale, we see breakthrough for a higher chromium concentration and double the sulfate concentration, 110 milligrams per liter. We see breakthrough, now we're in the thousands of bed volumes. So if you compare that to the 190,000 bed volumes we got for the weak base, you can see the difference. And then the Livermore water, we did see breakthrough. The influent concentration was only about 11 ppb, and the breakthrough curve went out later because the sulfate was 55. We did do some regeneration of the brine and looked at potential for recycle, and we did see that was a feasible option, and that's something that's underway in some testing at Stokel Creek right now, is how to really to hone in on this. Accumulation of constituents in brine, that's something else we looked at. So you can see here the chromium really builds up with each recycle of the brine that you would use, and we got up to 110 milligrams per liter of chromium after 7 recycles. You also build up your sulfate as well to pretty significant levels, and that can become problematic. And so there are some new thoughts about how to avoid that. here you can see some of the yellow water in the brine regeneration. And so that's where you might have to precipitate your chromium brine to minimize the amount of hazardous waste that you generate if you want to truck your brine, if you have to truck your brine away or dispose of it in the sewer and have restrictions on your concentration of chromium in the brine. And then just really briefly, the high-pressure membranes. This is something that has not been tested to in significant detail for chromium in particular, but theoretically should work. The high-pressure membranes involve the use of acid or scale inhibitor or pretreatment processes. You do generate a concentrate brine that can range from about 15 to 25% of your waste. You can have post-treatment. You need to have post-treatment or bypass, depending, for corrosion control as well. So this is just a summary of technology performance, which we already just went through. But the major pros for the weak base anion exchange is that it is very simple for operations, and it's proven for chrome 6 removal. It does have only one proven resin at full scale at this time, but that's underway in terms of looking at new treatment options there. Does require pre- and post-treatment. And then the waste classification can get you into that T-norm classification, which can be challenging. The RCF process, on the other hand, can absorb fluctuations a bit better, but it is a more complex process and has a much bigger footprint. So there is some work underway right now by a number of groups that are looking at whether you can really reduce the amount of reduction time and add chlorine and see if that really helps to improve the size of that treatment process and make it effective. And then the other two technologies, the strong base anion exchange is a proven chrome 6 removal technology but does have a brine waste. The high pressure membranes have a concentrate waste as well. So you really have to consider all of these things together in terms of process selection, and then also potential removal of other co-occurring constituents. If you're interested in nitrate or arsenic, those things would also drive which direction you may go. Just one slide on cost, which is very simplistic, but again, you can get a lot of this information and the details if you're interested in it. But it just shows the dollars per acre foot for all of these different options that we considered in these technologies for a 2,000 gallon a minute system for the weak base and the RCF processes. Now, there are pilot testing guidelines available. This is available on the Water Research Foundation website, and it gets into design, implementation, reporting guidelines with the purpose of trying to establish commonalities of treatment. Things that we explore in there are the detection limits that you should look for, looking specifically at the total chromium as well as chrome 6, and then how complete of a data set you'd even want to take. Like, how long would you want to run an RCF pilot in order to satisfy regulators and that sort of thing? This was a joint effort with the other project team members, were Phil Brandyuber of HDR, Isam Najam of WQTS, and Chad Seidel of Jacobs. And so we came together and established what these commonalities, the configuration to set up the operations, and the monitoring would be for these different classifications of technologies. I'm running out of time, so I won't go into this in detail, but these are the kind of things that you can find in, in that document. Again, you can look at different hydraulic loading rates and some details of how to set it up. And then a really key part is to establish reporting guidelines to make sure that that information is then available to the industry so that we understand what the limitations are for the technologies. So in general, we did, just to summarize the whole presentation today, initial studies did identify several technologies for chrome 6 removal, and these are coming out of years of work on this subject, being anion exchange, reduction coagulation, filtration, and high pressure membranes. We're also testing a couple others right now, like adsorptive media. So these are all kind of underway right now, but these are the most mature at this point in time. Each of the technologies does have major pros and cons, as we talked about, and so that each really has to be evaluated on a case-by-case basis. And then I just wanted to acknowledge the many people that have been involved in all of this work, and I thank you for your attention.